Very slightly. Okay. There's a tip. There's a tip. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome this evening. I'm Dougie Burnett. I'm the minister at Rhythm Park United Reformed Church on White Ladies Road. And I'm also the chair of Churches Together in Clifton, Cotton and Redland. And it really is delightful to see so many of you this evening. This is the second in our Lent series, and this year it is very much eco-themed. Just to say that with all of this, Churches Together in Clifton, Cotton and Redland works off a limited budget. We cover many events with that budget, but to help us with all of that, we do have a donations basket which you can put money into if you really want at the end of the meeting this evening. And Sarah is pointing to it just there. The basket is in her hand. It really does exist. So, with all of that, it is the second in our Lent series. It's all about faith, creation, and climate change. The speaker this evening is Mary Colwell. The title is Curlew's Conservation and Faith. It's a personal take on faith and the environment. Mary is a former BBC TV producer. She is an award-winning author. She is a campaigner for nature. She has 4 major conservation awards, including the RSPB Medal in 2022. She's written 4 books. She's successfully spearheaded the establishment of a GCSE in natural history. And in 2019, she set up the charity Curlew Action. She is the chair of the Curlew Recovery Partnership in England, and she has also recently advised the government on environmental matters. This is going to be a truly excellent evening, so please do welcome Mary. Thank you.
Actually, they're both journeys. They're journeys of both the mind and the heart, and they both have to be underlain by love. And I think there's so much similarity between the two in many ways. I thought that it would be good to talk about that tonight with everybody here, and how lovely it is to see so many people. Thank you for coming out on a truly miserable evening. First slide, please. The first similarity, I think, is faith. That was a spoiler. The first narrative is faith, because you have to have faith, obviously. Faith in our spiritual lives, faith in, for me, in what I'm doing. And faith is kind of a powerful word. It's a very, like all the words we use this evening, it's a very overused word, but if you really drill into it, it's quite a difficult word to understand. Because it requires, like all of it, so much from you personally. But faith, having faith, is not always easy. It's not always a nice, sweet ride, is it? And yet it accompanies you, or accompanies me, on all the journeys that I do, physical, spiritual, and intellectual, whether that's in my spiritual life or in the journeys that I'm on with the conservation world. Next slide. This is the start of a prayer that's often attributed to Oscar Romero, but it was actually written for Oscar Romero. And he said, "We accomplish in our lifetime only a tiny fraction of the magnificent enterprise that is God's work. Nothing we do is complete," which is a way of saying that the kingdom always lies beyond us. So that's what faith is, that we've always got a job to do, but the completion of it is always somewhere in the distance. And I think that's a really important part. Because if your faith is based in being successful and seeing the completion in the here and now, you'd give up. Because that's not the point. The point isn't to succeed now. The point is to add your bit to whatever will happen in the future. And you have to have faith that will come to fruition. Hope. That was taken in Ashton Court. Hope, I think, is summed up beautifully in the prayer by Emily Dickinson. "Hope is a thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me." And it's a beautiful thing that I just keep very close all the time. And in fact, when I walked the Camino halfway through, someone had written the first stanza, is it? On a wall, which was a very lovely thing to find when you're feeling tired and hungry. And it brings to mind this idea that hope is like a little bird that sits inside. And no matter what you're going through, no matter what all the emotions you're going through, whatever's happening to you on the outside, it just keeps singing the song of hope. And you don't have to feed it, you don't have to do anything. It never asks a crumb of me, it said. But it just keeps singing. So as long as that bird of hope keeps singing, you keep going. Because hope just keeps you going. So hope means having confidence in the future. Its hope is that you trust that you can make a difference, and that's really important. It's that you trust that you can do something that's worthwhile. But to live in hope isn't passive. You're not allowed to be passive. You've got to make hope possible rather than despair convincing. That's what we're charged to do, and that is radical and revolutionary. Because in today's world, it's far easier to make despair convincing than it is to make hope live in people's hearts. Far easier. And if you spend an absolutely appalling amount of time on social media like I do, you'll know exactly what that means. It's too easy to be cynical. It's too easy to be negative. It's too easy to find the enemy out there and bash them. Far, far more difficult to build the bridges, to find the common thread, to find the common vision, and work towards together with others to where you want to go. So to live with a hope that you can make a difference and that we'll live in a positive, better world, that's a radical way of life. And it's not a passive way of life. So it's a revolutionary, radical life, and that has to be inseparable from courage. So, courage. It's such a difficult word, really. Look at all those characters. That's a picture taken on the Camino. Those towering figures there. That those figures are painted on the side of a barn just before you enter the great big, what's called the Mesita, which is a big, forbidding, open plain you have to walk across for about 2 weeks. And those figures of inspiration and courage are there to help you along. But all of those figures, and many, many others, big and small, you gather them all in and you carry them with you wherever you go. Because without hope, faith and courage, it's very, very difficult to carry on. And those people, and many more, know what it was like to live lives of courage. So there we are. You can either give in to fear, that it's awful to stand up, you know, I feel really nervous before every single talk. I feel really nervous before doing anything. I went in to see a government minister the other day. She success name dropping, Damien Hine, and it's so nerve-wracking to stand outside that door before you go in, but you just have to just get on with it. So we're going to have
as
a
as you spend the next 2 weeks
from David Attenborough
debating, negotiating, persuading and compromising, as you surely must, it's easy to forget that ultimately the emergency climate comes down to a single number, the concentration of carbon in our atmosphere. The measure that greatly determines global temperature. And the changes in that one number is the clearest way to chart our own story, for it defines our relationship with our world. Today, those who've done the least to cause this problem are being the hardest hit. Ultimately, all of us will feel the impact, some of which are now unavoidable. Is this how our story is due to end? A tale of the smartest species doomed by that all too human characteristic of failing to see the bigger picture in pursuit of short-term goals. Perhaps the fact that the people most affected by climate change are no longer some imagined future generation, but young people alive today, perhaps that will give us the impetus we need to rewrite our story, to turn this tragedy into a triumph. We are, after all, the greatest problem solvers to have ever existed on Earth. We now understand this problem. Nature is a key ally. Wherever we restore the wild, it will recapture carbon and help us bring back balance to our planet. We're going to have to learn together how to achieve this, ensuring none are left behind. We must use this opportunity to create a more equal world. And our motivation should not be fear, but hope.
David Attenborough joins those other great figures in living a courageous life that's full of hope and full of faith in that there can be a better world. And I think in those times when it's quite difficult to carry on, these are the people that I just visualise and sit with for a while. And think, you know, use them to carry you for a bit. Samuel Johnson said that even a small amount of hope gives us courage, and boy, do we need courage at the moment. Every single one of us, every individual, every institution, every government. Because the mess we're in is so profound, really, that we're going to need a lot of courage to turn it around. But we are courageous people. Everybody's courageous. Everybody has the ability to be a hero and a leader. Courage, said Brené Brown, she's the psychologist who's great fun, if you don't know. Courage starts with showing up and just letting yourself be seen. It's as simple as that sometimes. You just show up, you know. You just stand up and say, it is scary, but I'm going to stand up anyway. And when you do that, when you put yourself out there, whether you're a big leading figure like the Attenboroughs and the Gandhis of this world, or whether you're just you and me, when you put yourself out there, you feel incredibly vulnerable. And that's a really important thing as well, as part of this journey of faith and in the environment. Because you have to be vulnerable. You have to know that you could be struck down. You have to know that it'll hurt sometimes. You have to know that you'll take a lot of body blows, but you have to know that you'll be carried through it. So nobody promises any of this is easy. Nobody. And being vulnerable and being open to that is very much a part of the journey as well. Be afraid to hurt. Vulnerability is terrifying. The courage it takes to reveal your heart is one of the most daunting and yet rewarding experiences in life. It will set you free. It is being open to wounding, to being hurt, exposed, attacked. But be vulnerable. Shake in your boots. the goodness that will come to you in the form of people, situations and things can only come when you're vulnerable. Life isn't about avoiding the bruises. It's about collecting the scars to prove that we showed up. It's very hard to put yourself out there. It's very hard to be vulnerable. But these people who do that are the dreamers, the thinkers and the creators. They are the magic people of the world. I thought that was such a good quote. That was such a good quote. Because there isn't anybody who doesn't take on a role on whatever level of trying to change things that doesn't say, I get that. I really get that. So one of the things I did was in 2016, I just finished a contract at the BBC, and these scientific reports were coming out, mainly from Ireland, that said that a bird called the Eurasian curlew was disappearing. I'm going to give you a bit of conservation lesson in a minute. So I decided that I was going to do something about it. And I didn't know what to do. I could write articles or I could, you know, but so what? So the thing that I decided to do was walk from the west of Ireland through to the east of England and find out for myself why they were disappearing. Find out, talk, explore, go to the places where the birds sing, go to the meadows where they don't sing anymore, talk to the scientists, the artists, the poets, the conservationists, the farmers, and that's what I did. All for that. All just for a bird with a long bill. I mean, seriously? Seriously? But if that isn't worth saving, I don't know where we are. If we can't look after the voiceless and the most vulnerable, then I'm not sure we deserve this planet at all. Another thing I did, my big hero in life is another one. You didn't see a picture of him earlier, but he's called John Muir. And there's a trail. He's a 19th century environmentalist and a writer and a mountaineer and a naturalist and a geologist and a botanist and anything else you can think of. A man of deep faith. He was Scottish and then went to live in America. And I read him all the time. I love his words. I love his spirit. And so I decided to go and find out more about him. And I walked the John Muir Trail, which starts in the Yosemite Valley and it ends at the top of Mount Whitney. 240 miles later, of a solo trek through the Californian mountains. But unless you go there, there's nothing there. You just backpack it all and you have to have food drops and all that kind of thing. But unless you do that, you'll never understand who John Muir was. You'll never understand him. There they are, that's some of the pictures. There's John Muir. Wouldn't you just love to have met him? Doesn't he look great? Apparently he talked a lot, but that's all right. Next one. And that was the book I wrote about him, inspired by John Muir. The only British biography of a Scottish naturalist who changed the face of America. Isn't that extraordinary? What he did, the work he did, the way he wrote, how he campaigned, the life he led literally changed the heart of America and established America's national parks. He's an amazing man. If you've not read any of him, I'm very jealous of you because it means you've got a wealth of wonder ahead of you. And at the very end of the book I wrote about him, I imagined what it would be like if John Muir took me somewhere at the end of his life. And I wrote, but I think after all the writing was done, the meetings attended and the politicians lobbied, he would smile kindly and ask us to go with him along a mountain track and climb to higher plains. Here he would point out the beauty of a small flower and the power of a glacier. He would delight in an ousel and chat to the pines, reveling in their stories of their wild lives. Then as the sun set, we would rest with him under a giant sequoia and quietly listen to the beat of nature's warm heart. Only then, would he say, can we begin to formulate the answers to our environmental woes. John Muir was somebody who was vulnerable. John Muir cried at the sight of people destroying the natural world. He watched these huge, big, giant sequoia forests being torn down. He saw the end of the passenger pigeon in North America, the most numerous bird in the world when it was in existence, billions of birds. And he saw us eradicate them from the face of North America. In fact, the very last passenger pigeon died in the year that he died. He saw the eradication of the bison of the Great Plains. And what broke his heart was he saw his much-loved valley called the Hetch Hetchy, which was a valley very, very similar to the Yosemite. He saw that dammed and filled with water to provide a massive reservoir. So he knew what it was like to be bruised and broken and to fail. And yet he never, ever gave up. And why I think he's such an extraordinary character. And then the other way of being vulnerable, in between lockdowns in 2020, we'd lifted one lockdown and we were just before we went into the next. I walked the Camino de Santiago solo, 500 miles across northern Spain, starting in the south of France, crossing the Pyrenees, and then walking to Santiago de Compostela. I did it in the winter time, and I did it on my own. And normally 330,000 people a year walk part or all of the Camino. Most of them just walk part of it, because it's quite a long time. I had virtually the whole thing to myself. I probably met about 12 people in the whole group. So, and again, that sense of being exposed in a time of plague, which is what it felt like. When I did it, there were no vaccines, and everybody was fearful and worried about the future. So to put yourself out to walk an ancient pilgrimage at a time when the world felt like it was falling apart just seemed to be a way for me to try to understand how this fitted into the great span of history, because pilgrims have always walked in plagues and wars and times of political upheaval, always. And it's never, that route has seen it all, and it will see us through the next lot of crises that we have as well. Thank you. But you can see that you do feel quite lonely sometimes. And people, when I got back, said, did you ever feel lonely? And I remember saying, no. And then I look at that picture and I say, yes, I really feel lonely. Especially as it rained an awful lot. So cold at times. This is from the book. I called it The Gathering Place. COVID sits alongside the other threats of climate change and loss of biodiversity as the unholy trinity of crises causing existential angst across the globe. The long-standing sacred cows of constant economic growth, development towards westernized lifestyles, and ever-increasing consumption seem at best misguided and at worst wanton foolishness. The economic box we had placed around the planet is slowly disintegrating, proving to be nothing like as secure as we had assumed. The vulnerability of humanity is being exposed. Walking a 1,000-year-old pilgrimage route is not an escape from these home truths. They come to meet you face to face. So being vulnerable means that you go out there and you face whatever it is that you're battling against. But it's absolutely essential to do it. And when you're walking something like the Camino, or the John Muir Trail, or the Curlew Walk, you realise, or I realised, that there's so many different sorts of time, and that's a great thing in faith as well. Time takes on very different aspects. Day-to-day time, which is just, how much longer have I got left to talk? I think I should be finishing. The right time, the kairos moment. It's the right time to do something. The time when the gods act, that's what that means. Relative time. Time is relative, as Einstein told us. Depends how fast you're moving, how heavy you are, all that kind of thing. Time is a shapeshifter. And time unfolding. All shall be well, when all shall be very well. And all that sense of time lives with you, weaves with you, goes in and out with you, and into your thoughts. As you're thinking through, or I was thinking through, all these things that I'm involved with, how time just is really urgent 1 minute, but you know you're just part of a massive journey the next. We live in a wondrous, wondrous world. We really, really do. Cleopatra launched 1,000 ships. Well, that bird launched a 500-mile walk. Isn't that the most beautiful sound? Is everybody familiar with it?
Yeah.
It's the bubbling call of the curlew. You'll hear it most likely from now on in the meadows and moors where it breeds. The nearest one to Bristol, the nearest breeding colonies are either in Gloucestershire, the Severn and Avon Vales, or down in the Somerset Levels. Next one, please. But this is why it was important to me to find out about it. The UK has lost over half of its breeding curlews just in 20 years. That's nearly 120,000 birds, which is equates to about 5,500 birds a year that we're losing. Thank you. And in 2015, at the end of 2015, it became the most pressing bird conservation priority in the UK because of the rapidity of its decline. And you can see, sorry. Please go back one. You see the graph on the right, that's the BTO breeding bird survey map, and just shows how much it's plummeting down to zero. The map in the middle, the actual map of UK and Ireland there, shows the loss of curlews over the last 20 years. Look at the car crash, which is Ireland. Ireland in the 1990s had between 5 and 8,000 breeding pairs of curlews. This year, this last year, the census they did in Ireland, I'm talking about Southern Ireland here, 98. Mm. So from 7,000 pairs to 98 since the 1990s, just to give you a benchmark. So anyway, just some statistics, but that just shows, so below that black line there, that sort of hockey stick shape, there's probably only 1,000 pairs left. And the whole of Ireland, and the whole of Wales, and the whole of southern England. And Wales, the home of the curlew, the BTO say it will be extinct as a breeding bird in Wales within 10 years. And this is on our watch, guys. Yes. So there it is, sitting vulnerable on its nest in the middle of a silage field. There is its eggs. How vulnerable are they? Yeah. Totally reliant on us not to destroy them. And those little things are so precious. That's a very, very rare sight. Most nests never get to that stage. And that's even more rare. You see that so rarely now, but that's a curlew not long off fledging. Reasons, though, that's why I'm so fascinated. They're beautiful, they're wondrous, they sound magnificent, they move you to tears. I could cry every time I hear one. But they're more than that. What they do is they shine a light on who we are, because they're disappearing because of the way we live. That's the hard reality. We've moved from extensive, low input, slow-paced farming to modern intensive farming. A bird nesting in that field will be cut for silage every 8 weeks. Not a chance of anything surviving in there. The way that we manage our landscapes now, both urban and in the countryside, means we have huge numbers of what we call meso-predators. We've eradicated all the top predators a long time ago. The middle-sized predators, doing really, really well. Birds of prey, thankfully, are recovering from decades and decades and decades of persecution. But we have the densest numbers of foxes and crows in the whole of Europe. And they eat everything. These are generalist predators. And they'll eat curlew eggs as well as your pizzas that you don't throw away in the street. Well, probably not your pizza. I'm sure you have a better response. But wow, I mean, that could have been taken outside my house on bin day on last Friday. Feeding them. The other big threat, of course, is climate change. Everybody thinks we need to plant lots of trees. We do need more trees. Next one, please. But we don't need this. We really, really don't need this. We don't need Sitka plantations everywhere. And where we're putting them, on so-called low-intensive grassland, is exactly where waders breed. So there are threats everywhere. We do need trees. We do. I'm not saying we don't. But sometimes the planting is not sensitive. And of course, we all know about climate change. You heard some of you came to that. I'm sure Ruth covered the big effects. And we all know in the West Country about flooding and the increase in storms and so on. And that's a map that shows from the BTO that just climate change alone, the effect that will have on curlew breeding population. So by 2080, look at the reduction, and it's pretty low now. So the thing is, the pressure against these birds is absolutely massive on every level, and it goes right to the heart of what humanity is and how we think and how we feel about the planet. That's why I'm so fascinated by them. They're a vehicle through which to look at the human heart, really. So what I did my curlew walk, and then after that, when I realised what was happening, I organised 4 national conferences. And I also started World Curlew Day. Do you know how, does anybody know, has anybody started a World Day? It's very difficult. Most of you just tell people, you just say, April 21st is World Curlew Day. Boom, there it is. Get yourself a logo, tell as many people as you can, get it out there, suddenly we've got a World Curlew Day. Honestly, that's how you do it. Well, that's how I did it. The logo was designed by my cousin. And April the 21st is John Muir's birthday, and also the average first laying date of a curlew in Western Europe. So it had to be April the 21st, doesn't it? So put it in your hearts, because you could do anything. You could have a coffee morning, go and find them, read a book about them, you know, tell your friends, write a poem. It doesn't matter what you do, but mark it, because they need us to love them. And curlews are great, they take you to really amazing places. Look at me swanking around outside number 10 with policymakers and heads of NGOs and all that kind of stuff. And it was all really interesting, and I have to say number 10's a lot scruffier than I thought it was. I didn't like to say, but they could do with a bit of a touch-up in the place. Anyway, so that was to discuss policy. Thank you. Next one. And my goodness, who knew that the now King Charles loves curlews? Did you know that? No, he loves them. And he organised 2 symposiums of his own. First one in Dartmoor in a hotel. Nobody, till that morning, told me I was sitting next to him. Nobody. And then another one at Highgrove. And it was a very funny incident in the Dartmoor one. For a start, I didn't know I was going to be sitting next to him, so I stayed in my camper van in the car park, because I couldn't afford to stay in the hotel. So when I woke up, it was surrounded by sniffer dogs. And secondly, because of my background, someone in the audience, and there was a big audience of landowners and gamekeepers and good associates, and someone said, I think this is so serious, we ought to get the BBC to make a documentary on curlew so everybody knows about it. And I said, I'm so sorry, but that will never happen. Curlews don't have big teeth and claws, and they don't eat antelopes. There's no way the BBC or anybody else will make a documentary on curlews. They're just not sexy enough. And Prince Charles stood up and said, at the time, he said, I entirely disagree. He said, I think curlews are damnably sexy. And he said, write to the statutory agencies and to the major NGOs, do something. And DEFRA seed funded what is called the Curlew Recovery Partnership England, which is a roundtable of major organisations. I've been made chair, and Ryan Burrell there is the manager. If you had told me in 2016 that I would be chair of a DEFRA funded round table of conservation organisations charged with the protection of curlew across England, I would never, ever, ever have believed you. Ever have believed you. The people I sit around with in that table are my heroes. It's just incredible. If you make yourself vulnerable and put yourself out there, what happens? Never would have believed you. Okay. And he even brought in, see the guy on the left there? Those of us of a certain age will remember Dave Gray as a big singer-songwriter, White Ladder, do you remember? Grooving out to David Gray. Yeah. He phoned me up and said, can I help you? I love curlews. And he and I do musical evenings around the country where I interview him about nature and music, and he plays live music. And we're doing one in Annick Castle soon. So anyway, so that's just a photo showing a range of different people. In that photo, Tiens Curlews brings us all together. There's a pop star, an investment banker, a gamekeeper, senior scientists, a fundraiser, people all coming together, rallying round one bird with a long bill. That's it. Thank you. Oh, there we go. And of course, what you need is perseverance. We just need perseverance. You need it in faith, in your faith life, when things are not going well, when you can't believe God allows things to happen that happen. But you know that you have to keep going. You can't put it any other way. That's the shock on the Camino. That was a morning, the day after I'd been snowed in for a day and just decided to set off anyway. And the stinging of the sort of snow against your face was really painful. And I, you know, you walk with your sort of hood over your face, really. And that St. Rock there, statue of St. Rock, and he was suffering as much as me, so I'm just going to go to him. Thank you. The poem that I started with, faith poem. We accomplish in our lifetime only a tiny fraction of the magnificent enterprise that is God's work. Nothing we do is complete, which is a way of saying that the kingdom always lies beyond us. That's what I said at the beginning. I have no idea whether we'll save Curlews. None at all. I can't tell you. If you get me on a good day, I'll say somewhere, we'll keep hold of them. Get me on a bad day, I say I don't think we can. So, but it doesn't matter what I think. It really doesn't matter what I think, because I just have to keep doing what I do. And then you get the rest of the poem. This is what we are about. We plant seeds that one day will grow. We water seeds already planted, knowing that they hold future promise. We lay foundations that need further development. We provide yeast that produces far beyond our capabilities. We cannot do everything, and there's a sense of liberation in realizing that. This enables us to do something, and to do it very well. It may be incomplete, but it is a beginning, a step along the way, an opportunity for the Lord's grace to enter and do the rest. We may never see the end results, but that is the difference between the master builder and the worker. We are workers, not master builders, ministers, not messiahs. I can't put it better than that. So whether it's in your spiritual life or in working towards whatever it is that you care deeply about, I truly wish you a good journey. Thank you.
That really was fabulous. I mean, I know you meant to say things like, it was fabulous, but it really was fabulous. There was depth, there was richness, there was so much there. We've got some minutes yet, so if you'd like to chat to your closest neighbours for a few minutes, pick up highlights for you, and then think about any questions you might like to ask. We've only got the one microphone here at the front, so when you've got some questions, after a few minutes, we'll need you to shout out those questions. Then Mary or myself will repeat the question over the microphone and we will share. So have some minutes, huh? And just rejoice in what we've heard. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the next one.
At the microphone. So, wave hands if you want to say something or ask a question. Just over here. Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was an amazing talk. I just wonder, in terms of protecting the curlews, have you got one thing that you think is more important or will have a greater impact than anything else?
In case you didn't hear that, the lady was asking, in terms of protecting curlews, is the one thing that's more important to do than anything else? Yes, I think there is. I think in terms of science and everything, we know how to protect them. There's no we know what to do now, but we don't have the will to do it. And so if there was one thing that I could do, it's work on the messaging. That's the most important, the communication. Tell people, get people to fall in love with the earth again, curlews and everything else. That's why the GCSE in natural history is so important to me. That's why it took 12 years to get it through the system. Because unless we know something, we won't love it. And we'll only know about things if we're taught about them. So for me, education and awareness raising is the most important thing we can do now to help them. We know what to do. We don't need any more science. We just need the will to put that into practice.
Thank you. Another question, please. Dave, thank you.
Does this government listen?
Well, it listened eventually. It took me, let's talk about the GCSE in natural history, I haven't really mentioned that. I came up with that in 2011. Shall I tell you the story? It's quite interesting. So the schools minister that has been the schools minister since about 1735 was a man called Nick Gibb. Now Nick Gibb was, I know ministers come and go all the time, but Nick Gibb never did. He stayed in post. So whoever was prime minister, Nick Gibb was the school minister. So it sat with Nick Gibb. We kept going to talk to him for years. Please, please, please say yes to a GCSE in natural history. And I know it's a difficult thing to do, and I know that curriculums are very, you know, nobody wants to put anything else in. But he would not listen, and he would not listen. He just had this thing, he didn't get it, kept saying, Mary, it is not knowledge. I'm only interested in knowledge. And I said, I don't know what you mean by that. And he said, knowledge is how you change things. This is just a list of facts. That was his. So anyway, now then. I'm going to say something which must never go outside this room. Because it's really important that this statement I'm about to make next does not go outside this room and is never taken out of context. But it's quite hard for me to say. Thank you, Boris Johnson. Because Boris Johnson sacked Nick Gibb and put in another minister called Robin Walker. Robin Walker was young, he's got a young family. His mum is a birder, and he got it immediately. And when I went to see him, he said, eventually, it took him a little while, but it took him a matter of a few months, he said yes to it, right? Amazing. It was amazing. Then Robin Walker resigned because of Boris Johnson and that big mass resignation. Rishi Sunak put Nick Gibb back in. So that's why, once it had said yes, stalled now because Nick Gibb sat on it and wouldn't progress it. But Nick Gibb went in December. You know, there was a big reshuffle, do you remember? Was it December? Anyway, people. And a new minister has come back in, another minister called Damon Hind, who's who I went to see. Will he listen? Will he do anything? I don't know. I've given up beginning to. I don't know. If anybody can advise me on the power play between civil servants and ministers, and who actually holds the power, I would love to know, because I haven't been able to work now. So yes, it depends who's in power, actually, is the long way of saying probably, sometimes.
That's a super talk, thank you very much. Just so struck by that drop-off from 2015-16, was it? And I just wondered, do the scientists on your group, on your panel, do they put it down to what changed in 2015-16? What changed in agriculture? What changed in climate that precipitates such a huge decline?
It's not so much that it suddenly changed in 2015. It started to decline in about 1980s. And it's really the agricultural policy. It was really the one-size-fits-all, intensify. And farming just switched. 70s, 80s, it just, the land was transformed, and that's what did it. And by the time we get them, curlews live for 35 years. They're long, long-lived birds. So you don't start to see the drop-off until a bit later, but that's why. So we have a chance to put it right, but there's no sign we're going to put it right yet. And the problem with being now outside Europe is that once you have a pan-European policy, it can do terrible things, which it has done for wildlife, but it is starting to put it right in Europe, and we're not at the moment.
Thank you. We've got time for a couple more questions.
How is Europe going to get right?
They're chained there. Well, it depends what country you go to, but there is, say for example, in the Netherlands, they've introduced a payment system to farmers which is far more flexible and bottom up than we have, which is a much more top down type of system. And they have the ability to mass change payments, and everything is driven by money. So they are much more sensitive now to, and it's not just about COVID, you know, it's about the health of everybody's cotton. It really matters about the health of soils, the health of grasslands, climate change, everything's all interlinked. And so everybody is on to, we've got to make farming a lot more sustainable. And if you've got a mass sort of policy, you can do that quite quickly. And I think that's the signs that we're beginning to see in Europe at the moment.
And related to that, there's been huge protests, though, haven't there, from the farmers in Europe.
Yeah.
And also I saw on Countryfile the same here. They don't seem to feel that it's viable economically to look at, you know, to look after the environment.
Yeah.
Because there are so many other countries not doing it, you get cheap food from them.
Yeah.
So is there an answer to that?
I'm way above my pay grade. I'm sure there's lots of problems. I really don't feel qualified to answer the why there's lots of strikes at the moment and how to put that right. I mean, there's going to be such complex relationships between countries. We're in a really complicated situation now with two wars which are affecting things. So honestly, it's not that I don't want to answer it. I just don't feel qualified to answer that.
I'm just wondering if, as individuals, we ought to be looking at where our food comes from.
Yes.
And making those choices.
Yes.
If the farmers here can do it but at a price, then we should pay the price, maybe.
Yeah, just get involved, I think. Yes, if you can, of course, support the farmers that are doing the right thing. But that's not to vilify farmers that are intensive. That's the system that we've told them to work within. So it's not a matter of saying you're bad and you're good. It's not that. It's working with whoever's in power, whatever government's in power, whatever civil servants, and getting them to understand that it matters to citizens. Because they do listen. They do listen to what people say. They care about whether you like them or not. They really do, surprisingly.
I know I'm a deaf old man, but why does the media persist in just talking about climate change and not the ecological crisis?
I couldn't agree with you.
Could you repeat the question?
Yes, why does the media only concentrate on climate change and not talk about the loss of wildlife and biodiversity, which is a brilliant question, and I can't tell you how important that question is to me. And so, yes, I don't know. I don't know. I think it's because it's easier to talk about storms and you know, it's kind of easier in a way. The effects of climate change we're seeing really quite dramatically. The loss of curlews, you know, it's sad, isn't it? But so I think people don't make the connection between the disappearance of wildlife and the degradation of ecosystems and therefore the effect on us. I don't think those connections are being made. And it's a big uphill struggle. It's getting better. It's getting better, but it's nowhere near enough. But they're interlinked. They're completely interlinked anyway. But yes, I agree with you.
There's river pollution and there's plastic pollution all
yes.
around the world.
Yeah.
We hear very little about it.
We do. We do. It's all about climate change and hence the pressure to plant trees all the time. So if you don't take a holistic view, if you only take, I'm just going to worry about climate change, then you can make the wrong decisions in the bigger picture, which is why it's so important that we become informed about and make the right decisions for everything. But I agree with you entirely.
One last question.
Two.
Just there, thank you.
I was wondering if, growing out of these last couple of questions, whether if we can persuade people to be a bit more caring about curlews and other small species and things, do you think there's any possibility that people might start caring about each other a bit more as well? About these stabbings and stuff like that that's increasing? That worries me.
Yes, the lady said that if we start to care about wildlife, would that then mean that we're more likely to care for each other? I think caring breeds caring, don't you? It's a mindset, you know. It's a mindset. So hopefully, And also I think a lot of the stuff we see is a frustration and a depression and an anger at the world. And one of the reasons why we know the connection between caring about the natural world and mental health and well-being. They're very, very connected. Another real reason why I was so keen on this GCSE in natural history.
I'm told by Sarah, a final question, just there.
Ah, Mary.
I was going to ask how you maintain food security as a growing population if you're going to go back to more traditional farming methods and if you're going to support rewilding and re-establishing the kinds of places where farming is going to thrive.
Yes, I think it's a good question. Why, if we're going to, can we feed the population if we go back to a more, if you like, older-fashioned type of farming, but I don't think that's the way to look at it. I think farming can be very productive, but not as destructive. And I think we all have to be a lot better at being sensible about what we use and how we throw away. We can't throw away 50% of what we buy. There's plenty of food if we just used it resourcefully and well and with respect. So I don't think it's as simple as that.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this has been a truly excellent evening. And I think I've picked up a lot of quotes and sermon illustrations for future use. So, once again, please, a huge round of applause for me. So just to say, a huge thanks to Clifton Cathedral for hosting us this evening. Thank you to Rita and all the team from Clifton Cathedral. Just to say, with up and coming events, we've got the World Day of Prayer this Friday, March the 1st, at Victoria Methodist Church. Refresh.